27 with joint appointments in optical science, astronomy, and mechanical engineering. Dr. Bugier is founding director of the GARS Optics Fabrication and Testing Group, with responsibility of developing and implementing advanced technology for metallic and measurement astronomical mirrors of the University of Arizona. Dr. Bugier has over 300 publications in the fields of the optical engineering, metrology, precision mechanics, and optical fabrication. He is fellow of SPI and OSA and founding a partner of companies that have commercially advanced measurements in computer methods, Arizona Optical Metrology and Arizona Optical System. Let's welcome Professor.
Thank you, Amalia, for the introduction, and I want to thank the directors here for inviting me to come speak to you, and thank you all for coming to listen to me. So, I'm going to talk about fabrication and testing of optics for large telescopes. As Molly said, I'm from University of Arizona, where I've actually retired in the last year. I maintain a role there, but I spent most of my time with my new endeavor here, which is a company called Arizona Optical Systems. So, today's talk, I want to talk about some issues with astronomical telescopes. It was an introduction. I didn't know when I put the talk together how technical the whole audience would be and how much everybody would know optics and telescopes. So I take a step back, and if I bore you too much, I'll try to go quickly here. But then getting into the more interesting things, I'll talk about advanced mirror technologies that are implemented for the next generation telescopes. And then getting more specific, I'll talk about some of the specialized measurement techniques that I've developed and that we've implemented for making the very large telescopes University of Arizona. So first of all, my background, I'm from Tucson, Arizona, which you don't know is right near the Mexico border. Nogales is right on the border. And about 100 kilometers away is Tucson, Arizona, where I've lived for 30 years. And Tucson is... It's a city of about 500,000 people, so it's smaller than the city. It's in a desert, in the Sonoran Desert, so it's similar to Sonoran, Mexico. And we have fantastic wildlife there. We have outdoors, nice sunsets, and very large saguaro cactus. And I see there are a lot of interesting cactus here that are not familiar to me. We have different cactus in Maryland. So, I'm going to start with this. This is the Giant Magellan Telescope. This is a telescope that's being built by a collaboration of 10 different institutes. The optics are led by the University of Arizona. And this is a giant telescope. You see, this is an artist's picture of what it will look like. You can see maybe here, this is a person. Okay? This telescope here, it is 25 meters across, is the collecting aperture. Each of these pieces is 8.4 meters. Okay, so this is a giant telescope. And so what I want to do today is sort of tell you how we get there. Why do we think we can make such a thing? So, looking at the pieces, light comes from the star, it hits the primary mirror. That's the most difficult optic in any telescope. It's the secondary mirror. We have a special implementation of the secondary mirrors for this telescope. I'll tell you that. And then the light comes to focus in an area where the instruments are. And underneath here, there's a set of six different instruments that do imaging and spectroscopy over a wide range of wavelengths. I'm not going to talk about the imaging and the spectroscopy. So, why big telescopes? This telescope is going to end up costing almost $1 billion. Okay, why do we need a telescope so big? Well, there are really two things that drive us to largeness for telescopes. One of them is angular resolution. being able to see fine details because of diffraction requires a large diameter. The angular resolution goes inversely proportional to the diameter. The only way to see small features is with a large diameter. The other is sensitivity. We want to see sharp things, and we want to see things that are dim. Now, they're not actually dim if you are next to them, but you're not. They're many light years away. Okay? They're far away, and so they appear dim to us, and so we need a large aperture to collect the light and to be able to see them. So these three images illustrate this, where this is an image of a globular cluster here. This is from the Hubble Space Telescope, which is 2.4 meters in diameter, and it's in space. Okay? And you can see that it makes an image here, but it barely resolves the fact that there are individual stars. Take an 8-meter telescope, use adaptive optics to correct the atmosphere, and you can see that there are a number of stars in here. Okay? If you take the Giant Magellan Telescope, this is a computer simulation because we haven't actually made the telescope, and you can resolve incredible detail in the distribution of these stars. Okay? And so that's the resolution. That's what one of the things that drives us. But look at this, the time that it takes. This is a 1,000 second image on the Hubble Space Telescope. Okay? We go to the Gemini Telescope. Now we can make that same image in 100 seconds. GMT can make that image in 14 seconds. Okay? So we can collect more images, or even better yet, we can go to deeper and deeper angles. So that's what drives us. That's why we're willing to spend $1 billion to create this giant telescope. So, a little bit of history of telescopes. The first astronomical known use of a telescope was Galileo, who took a simple telescope and he pointed it out and he discovered all kinds of interesting things about our solar system. And he's limited by the collecting aperture here. It's relatively small, only this big. And the image quality isn't particularly good, but it was a giant step forward because you can see things that nobody could see before. And there's a progression of this type of telescope. Kepler built instruments that were more optimized for astronomy. A continued evolution to larger and larger refractors. Refractors are telescopes that use lenses. A key development was the quality of the glass, being able to make glass that's higher quality and understanding how to compensate for dispersion. So that allowed the creation of larger and larger lenses. This is a lens, this is the Lick telescope. And so this lens, the objective up here is 36 inches in diameter. So even by today's standards, that's a large lens. And look at the ratio of the size of the aperture here to the volume of the enclosure. Okay, you see that with this type of telescope, you need a very large enclosure, many, many times larger than the size of the aperture. The largest of the refractors is the 40-inch Syracuse refractor, University of Chicago, and this is similar. Again, this is about this big, lenses. The fundamental issue with lenses is that as they get bigger, they also have to get thicker, and so they get heavier and harder to support. And the quality of the glass becomes a fundamental limitation. And so, as you know, we go away from lenses for making large systems, and we use mirrors. And we didn't figure this out. Like almost everything, Isaac Newton figured it out first. He made a small reflective telescope, and he pointed it at the sky. And we called it telescope style that he made, a Newtonian telescope. And this avoids the problem of having to look through the glass, and it changes the technical problem into making the mirror. So now to be able to make a sharp image, the mirror surface needs to be very good, and the mirror needs to be reflective. The light has to reflect from it. So early mirrors were made from metal, and polished metal is shiny, so it reflects. There were larger versions of these. This is a 48-inch mirror that was built in Ireland, I think. I remember that. Anyway, so this is the taking that idea of metal mirrors and making them as large as you can until you reach practical limit. This is the Ross telescope. This is the biggest of these, which was this big across, 72 inches, 1.8 meters. And it's a metal mirror that's polished so it's shiny. But the problem with metal is it's not stable. Okay, the shine on it's not stable. It tarnishes, so it has to be repolished. But the shape's not stable. Metal's not a stable material. And so if the shape of the mirror changes, then the image quality changes. So it's very difficult to make mirrors out of metal. Foucault solved this problem by making mirrors from glass. And the big development that he had was to make the mirror from glass, which has poor reflectivity, but then apply a thin metal film so that the metal film that's on the glass provides the reflectivity, but the underlying glass provides the shape. The shape of the mirror is what determines the quality of the wavefront that's reflected. So metal or glass mirrors have been scaled up. This is a 100-inch telescope, which was Hubble's telescope. They discovered, used the data from, discovered the expansion of the universe. This uses a Cassegrain type design, which is the common design now, similar to what I showed with the GMT, where the primary mirror reflects light to the secondary mirror that then sends light off to the detector, which at one point was the eye. And then later it was photographic film, and now all detection is done with solid state devices in one form or another. This was the largest of that class of telescope. This is an artist's picture of the 200-inch telescope. So the primary is down here. This is on Mount Wilson. This is a very large telescope built in the 1940s. 200 inches in the diameter, so over five meters. So if we can make big telescopes, we can make perfect images, right? Well, we're looking through the atmosphere. Hubble Space Telescope solves that problem by being above the atmosphere, but that's very, very expensive. We can't do that very often. Our ground-based telescopes have to look through the atmosphere. For some wavelengths, the light doesn't make it through the atmosphere. We can't do anything. But for the other wavelengths, the light does go through the atmosphere, but it's distorted. So we can fix that by compensating the atmospheric distortion with adaptive optics. An adaptive optic system has in it a set of mirrors here, or an optical system that has two key elements. One is there's a wavefront sensor that senses the phase variations due to the atmosphere. And then there's also a deformable mirror that changes its shape to compensate for the atmosphere. And then there's a computer that ties these two things together so that the wavefront sensor information is fed to the deformable mirror faster than the atmosphere is changing. And so whatever the irregularities are in the atmosphere, the deformable mirror can make a correction real time. And that's adaptive optics. So there are issues with this. One is that it requires this whole chain of systems. Light's lost at each mirror reflection. And also, a lot of the science we do is in the thermal infrared. And each of these mirrors, unless they're cold, have a thermal background, very large compared to the thing we're looking at. So for GMT and for some other telescopes I'll show you, we've solved this problem with a different architecture of the design, where we actually make the secondary mirror in the telescope the deformable mirror for the adaptive optics. Okay, and so what that means is that this telescope can work by having only three warm surfaces, the primary, the secondary, and a window here, which is a dichroic. And there are only the two reflections that we lose light from. And so it's much more efficient. It's at a cost of complexity of the telescope. Because if the secondary mirror is the adaptive element, if it's not working, everything's bad. Okay, so we require a very robust system. So we built one of these. This was in 2001. This is the MMT, which is a 6.5 meter telescope on Mount Hopkins. We made an adaptive secondary mirror that has a very thin glass mirror. This one is 65 centimeters in diameter. And only 2 millimeters thick. Okay? And it has an array of actuators behind it that push and pull on this thin glass mirror to change its shape. And then there's electronics and all kinds of things to make the whole thing work. This is a picture of that mirror. And this is the secondary mirror in the MMT telescope. Another issue for adaptive optics for ground-based telescopes is the source for the wavefront sensor. So to do adaptive optics, you need a bright source to be able to determine what the light perturbations are. That's easy if you're looking at a bright star. Unfortunately, most of the science, the things that we want to look at, are dim, and we can't use them as the signature. So we create our own star. The way we do that is with lasers. We take lasers and we shoot them into the atmosphere. There's a thin layer of sodium 90 kilometers above the ground. We get a resonant backscatter from that sodium, and that shows up as what we call a laser guide star. And we use that as the reference for the adaptive optics system. So this is a depiction of the GMT secondary mirror. And so there are seven of these secondary mirrors. Each one is 1.1 meters in diameter. And they're very similar to the MMT. They're made of thin glass with an array of actuators behind it. This is the secondary that was built for one of our telescopes. I'll talk about it in a minute, the Large Binocular Telescope. It's the same design. This was a little bit different shape. It's about 1 meter in diameter, 2 millimeters thick, 672 actuators. And this is now on the telescope doing science. And this shows what you can do with adaptive optics. You see, this is the image, the big image, is without adaptive optics. And so this is what it looks like looking through the atmosphere. The atmosphere is causing perturbations, it causes blur. This is a pretty good image. This is much less than an arc second in diameter. But when we turn on the adaptive optics, okay, then we get a full correction of that. And what you see here is, you see this binary. These two stars here are only 1/6 of an arc second across. And we can easily resolve them. And we can make long exposures to study what's going on. So this is the performance of real adaptive optics. OK, so going to bigger telescopes, there are different technologies that you can use to make large mirrors. One is to use relatively thin mirrors, not 2 millimeters thick like what I talked about. It's something that's several 20 centimeters thick. And that works up to about 8 meters, and I'll show you some examples of those. You can make a big telescope from a lot of smaller segments. And there are telescopes that do that, and there are projects that plan to scale that up, and I'll talk about those. What we've chosen to do for the Giant Magellan Telescope is to start with the largest segments that we can make, which are 8.4 meters, and make them stiff so they're easy to support, and then put those together to create a larger telescope. And that's the concept for the Giant Magellan Telescope. So the thin mirrors have been very successful. The most famous of these is the Very Large Telescope, the VLT, that European Southern Observatory is built in Chile. This is a system of four telescopes, each one of which is 8 meters in diameter, and the primary mirror is about 30 centimeters thick, and it's made of solid zirconium glass. Okay? And at a diameter of 8.4 meters, and with that thickness, then the deformation of this glass due to the telescope moving around is very important. And so they have an active control system that maintains the shape. And it's a complicated control system, but they worked through the engineering and they got it right. And these telescopes perform fantastically well. There are some other ones, the Gemini telescopes. I showed you the initial image of the globular cluster that was taken from the Gemini telescopes. And there are two of those. Another way to make big mirrors is with small segments. Okay, and the most famous of these telescopes that do this is the Keck telescope. Keck telescope, the primary mirror here is 10 meters in diameter, and it's made from segments that are 1.8 meters across. And there are 36 of these segments. There's a control system behind the segments to maintain the position of each of the segments during the exposures, such that all of the segments together act like a single mirror. Okay, so it relies on a very sophisticated control system, but it works. This shows one of the segments. This is actually from a different, similar telescope, the Grand Telescopio Canarias. It's the same size, similar design. Okay, and so this shows one of the mirror segments. And they're about, the segments are solid glass, 75 millimeters thick. And so they're held into the system to create what looks like, to the light, a single primary mirror, except with little gaps between them, and those little gaps have a relatively small area. This is another version of a segmented telescope. There are two telescopes that use segments that are actually spherical. And so if you take a Cassegrain telescope, the Cassegrain requires a mirror that's near paraboloidal, and that means that different segments have to have different shapes. If you can make a mirror with a spherical primary, all the segments are the same. And so there are two telescopes that did this. There's the Habig-Eberly telescope in Texas and the South African Large Telescope. And these telescopes have 11 meter primary mirrors made of hundreds of 1 meter class segments. Okay, planning this forward with these, there are two projects planning very large telescopes using the segmented idea. This is the 30 meter telescope. This is planned by a group that's led by universities of California, and it's 30 meters in diameter. This is an enormous telescope. And to be able to get a 30 meter primary from segments, there need to be a lot of segments. And so this has about 500 segments, each one of which is 1.4 meters across. And these primary mirror is not spherical. Okay, this is near paraboloidal, and so the segment shape, as you go from the center to the edge, changes fairly dramatically. And this is a real challenge for making the segments. There are 500 segments. There are actually 82 different segment shapes that have to be made to be able to put this telescope on. This shows a picture of a prototype of these segments. They're about 50 millimeters thick. They're supported by a complex electromechanical system that maintains the position of the segment, but also it has actuators in it to maintain the shape of the segment. There's another, even larger telescope planned by the European Southern Observatories. These are the same people who built the VLT that I showed you with the 4 8-meter primaries. They're planning a mirror, they're planning a telescope they call now the European Extremely Large Telescope with a 39-meter primary mirror. This shows what it looks like, where it uses, again, segments of the same size, 1.4 meters. Now there are 800 of them. And they have a similar design for the electromechanical system. So to make a telescope work to very large diameter with small segments requires a lot of complexity. It requires a lot of segments to be made, each one of which has to be polished and supported. And in operation, each of these segments has its own degrees of freedom. It can shift in its position, or it can bend. All of those things need to be controlled, or the telescope doesn't achieve high performance.
Just to have an idea of the magnitude of the prices of all these giant telescopes, how do these telescopes compare with the Hubble telescope in space?
So the question's about cost.
The question about cost.
So they haven't built these telescopes yet.
So
these telescopes are one plus some billion dollars. The Hubble telescope initially was on the order of $1 billion in 1990. The fix for the problem in the Hubble telescope also was about $1 billion. Maybe a different relationship here is the James Webb Space Telescope. The James Webb Space Telescope is a 6.5 meter space telescope that's being built by NASA. I'm not talking about this here, but just for scale. That's the current one to compare this with. That one will cost about $10 billion. And it's 6.5 meters, and these are 30 meters. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
And this, which is the public cost of this?
It's about $1.5 billion.
Compared to 10?
Yeah, so a factor of 10 different approximately.
Okay, even that complexity is cheaper than...
Oh yeah, space, that's right. The complexity of space is makes anything you do on the ground is lower expensive.
Yes.
Okay, so then going back to walking us into the giant Magellan. So we built this telescope in the 1970s, or the University of Arizona did. I didn't, I was a boy. This is a multiple mirror telescope. It's actually a multiple telescope telescope. The MMT has six telescopes, 1.8 meters in diameter, that are all in the same mount and they're combined. Okay, and so this was built then, and it was successful. It was the first of this active type of telescope. And this telescope had a very special property. The primary mirrors were leftover mirror blanks from a space program. Okay, and so they were lightweight. They were zero expansion glass, and they're fairly deep, but they're mostly empty. They're sandwich construction. And so this telescope achieved surprisingly good performance because the mirror, because it's lightweight, attained the same temperature as the air around it, which then avoided the problem of air currents that destroy the image. So, in the meantime, after that telescope was operational, Roger Angel led the group to take this idea of light-weighted glass mirrors and make giant ones. And we built the technology that led to, this is the first of the primary mirrors for the large binocular telescope. But this shows the basic idea here. This is a casting, so this is a glass mirror that's manufactured such that when it comes off of the oven, when we're done casting it, it has a top surface that's curved close to the final surface. We get this by spinning the oven. I'll show you this shortly. It has a back surface that's defined where the liquid glass goes, and that's connected with the set of honeycombs, the honeycomb ribs. And so this mirror, it looks like it's almost a meter deep here. On the edge, it's almost a meter, but it's mostly empty. Okay, and so this is a fairly lightweight mirror for its size. Because it's so deep, it's very stiff, and so it's easy to support. So back to the MMT. We built the MMT, and we had money to improve it. And we had two options. One was to make these mirrors higher quality. The other one we followed, which was to replace them. And so we replaced this assembly of mirrors with a single mirror and a single telescope, which is 6.5 meters in diameter. And this is the telescope that we used for the adaptive optics development that I showed you earlier. So we can make mirrors that are up to 8.4 meters in diameter with the spin casting. And so to get a larger telescope, what do? We go back to our idea that we used for MMT. At that time, the biggest mirrors we could get of this quality were 1.8 meters, so we combined them. So now we do mirrors that are 8.4 meters, we combine them. And we create what we call a large binocular telescope. And this has two telescopes. Okay, and then the two telescopes are combined, and so you get an image that has the quality achieved by both telescopes at the same time. And this is a picture of the telescope on Mount Graham in Arizona. And so here's the idea. If we start with a number of telescopes, we can combine them for a bigger one. We do this. We can make mirrors and telescopes that are up to 8.4 meters. We combine them. We have two of them for the large binocular telescope. That's a stepping stone to the Giant Magellan Telescope. The Giant Magellan Telescope takes this idea to the next step. We can make mirrors of 8.4 meters. That enables us to make a telescope of 25 meters. Now, instead of the complexion of 500 or 800 individual mirror segments, we've reduced that complexity to 7. we have 7 mirror segments that we need to hold in the telescope. So that makes our operational complexity much, much lower. The challenge is making these mirrors, and that gets to the more technical portion of this talk. So an interesting concept here, the MMT had 6 telescopes together. The LBT has 2 separate telescopes that are together. The GMT, Giant Magellan Telescope, has a segmented primary mirror, and it also has a segmented secondary mirror. And you can think of this telescope as an array of 7 telescopes. If you take the light that hits one primary segment, it hits a single secondary segment, and then that light comes to focus. That by itself is an 8.4 meter telescope. Well, there's another one right next to it, and another one, another one. So all 7 of those 8.4 meter telescopes are co-imaged and co-phased to the same point. And so this works like an array of 7 telescopes. And this enables our control system to be much, much easier, because now we don't have to control the phase of the primary. Okay, if the primary mirror segment moves by 100 microns, which it certainly will, we need to correct it by moving the secondary mirror, which we can do very quickly because it has fast actuators. So this enables us to keep the complexity low down here where the primary mirror is. The difficulty is making these mirrors. This is a very fast telescope. This primary focal ratio is at 0.7. And so by telescopes, it's very steep. That enables this telescope to be not much smaller than the building that it's in. If you remember the Lick refractor, there was a relatively small aperture in a giant building. That building isn't that much smaller than the building with the Giant Magellan Telescopes. Okay, so how do we make these mirrors? Well, first we need to cast the glass. We do this by building up a mold. So we create the mold here with this ceramic fiber, these what we call cores, the boxes that we bolt down to the floor in the oven. Okay, they're made of ceramic fiber, which is a material that survives the casting. It doesn't interact with the glass, and it's soft enough that once we're done, we can remove it. And so for GMT, we create this shape with 600, almost 1,700 of these. And these define what will become the voids, the empty areas in the glass mirror. And then we put the glass in. The glass is manufactured in Japan from Alhara. It's low expansion borosilicate glass. We load the glass into the oven. Okay, and so it's sitting on top of the mold. The oven has walls and a ceiling and a floor with electrical heater panels. We heat it, and the glass becomes soft, becomes liquid, and then it becomes low viscosity and flows down into the mold. So this is an image or a movie taken from a camera inside the thing. And so this is sped up. That whole process takes maybe 10 hours. Okay, but that enables us to start with solid glass and create what for us is a solid glass primary mirror of this complex shape, 8.4 meters in diameter. So this shows the outside of the oven. During the casting, we spin the oven. The entire oven rotates such that the liquid surface of the glass will naturally take a curved surface, which is close to the final surface of the mirror. So once we're done, we remove the outside of the oven here. We're left with a single piece of glass. Inside of it is still the mold material. So the next step is to remove the mold material. So we have a special fixture that we use to pick up this mirror with a crane. We put it into a handling ring, tilt it up on edge. This is what the back of the mirror looks like. The front is a curved surface. The back is flat. This is what is the floor in the oven. So when we pick this up, much of the floor comes with it because it was cast with the glass. And then we take that apart. There are technicians here that remove these portions of the oven floor and remove the mold materials from inside. And once we're done, we have a single piece of glass that's mostly hollow. And to make the optical surface on that, our first step is to generate it. We have a diamond generating machine here. It has a spindle with a wheel that moves quickly. It has diamond teeth. And it's moved by computer control across the surface as this is rotated to give us the desired shape. GMT, because it's an F.7 paraboloid, but the segments are off to the side, except for the center one, they are an off-axis shape. When we look at the aspheric shape that we need to put into the mirror, it looks like this. Okay, where this is 14.5 millimeters of deviation from the best fit sphere. We have to machine this in with our diamond generator. So that's our first step. We machine this in to an accuracy of maybe 100 microns or so. And then we go through a stage of grinding and polishing. First we grind with loose abrasives to wear the surface down and to drive it to closer and closer to perfection. And then we polish it with classical polishing with pitch and rouge or polishing compound. But this mirror shape, you remember, has this very steep aspheric, this very steep complex shape. And so the way we accommodate that is we have this complex polishing tool. This we call a stressed lap polisher. And this is driven across the part and rubs on the surface. And it's that rubbing motion that gives us removal that polishes the surface. But it has actuators that change its shape. And so as it moves from one place to the next, or as it rotates, it's actively changed in shape so that it always fits the aspheric shape of the primary mirror. And so we use this and some other tools to finish the first of the GMT segments. This shows an image here of the surface departure from ideal, which is only 19 nanometers. This is a relatively large tool. This is a 1.2 meter tool. To finish the mirror, we also use smaller tools. This is a small tool. This one's 30 centimeters in diameter, and it's stroked like this. We use this to address the smaller features, things that we can't get to with a 1.2 meter. So the key thing about manufacturing optical surfaces is that if you build a polishing tool that fits, which we've done with the stressed lap or with this special tool, polishing tool fits, if you rub that tool on the part, it'll wear the part down. It removes material, and that changes its shape. To be able to make the correct shape, what we have to do is make a measurement. We look at the surface, and we compare its shape with the ideal shape, and we see which regions are high compared to what should be there, and which regions are low. And then what we do is with our polishers, we rub on the high spots. We wear them down so that they get to the same level as the low spots. But the challenge here is in the measurements. If we have to make a correct measurement so we know where the high spots are, and we have to know how big they are and exactly their shape, or we cannot converge with our polishing. And so it's the optical testing, the optical measurements that really drive the shaping of any aspheric surface. Of these in particular. And so, this is just what I said here, there's a really important thing here, which is the mirror is made based on the optical test. If the optical test is wrong, then the mirror shape will be wrong. And the great example of that is the Hubble Space Telescope, which we talked about a minute ago, which cost about $1 billion to build. It's only 2.4 meters in diameter. Manufactured, the primary mirror was manufactured in Connecticut, and they made a mistake in their optical test. Because of that mistake, they made the mirror that was incorrect. So they built the telescope, they expected to get images that looked like this. When they opened it up, they got images that looked like that. Okay? Why? Because there was a mistake in the optical test, and that the polishing is based entirely on the optical test. So, we recognize the importance of getting this right. Now for Hubble, there was so much money and interest in this already that there's a correction in the telescope. And so the primary mirror still has the same incorrect shape, but all of the subsequent instruments, astronauts serviced this, and they replaced the instruments in there with instruments that correct for the misshapen primary mirror in a similar way that adaptive optics corrects for the atmosphere. And so now the Hubble Space Telescope achieves the images that it was initially planned. Okay, so I'm going to continue on the mirror manufacturing theme here, and I'll come back to testing. So our next step, when we make a mirror, we get the shape so that it's right, we have our test, and we have a verification of the test, I'll talk about, then we need to get it to the telescope. So this shows the LBT mirror, one of the primaries for the large binocular telescope. It goes into a special, goes onto a special support, it goes into a special box, it goes onto a special truck. Okay, and this shows the truck going down the highway, you see it takes the entire road. So it takes a special permit and special planning to do it. This shows the road in, out where it's flat. Where are the telescopes? They're up on the mountaintop. Okay? The roads aren't as flat. And so that special truck also tilts the mirror up on its edge to be able to maneuver the mountain roads. Okay? And so this is part of the cost and the challenge of going to very large mirror segments. Every step is difficult and expensive. But as we see for GMT, if we can do it with 8.4 meters, we only need 7. Where if we want to do it with smaller segments, we need hundreds of hundreds. So then at the telescope, it gets installed and it needs to be cleaned for its coating. Mirrors of this size, to clean them, you have to walk on them. We have the technicians go out scrub the mirror to get it clean. For LBT, the vacuum chamber for the coating is mounted to the telescope. It's moved from its storage, bolted onto the telescope, evacuated, and then evaporated. We put aluminum onto the primary mirrors. We take it off, and this shows what the primary mirror looks like, which is the optical surface we achieved in polishing with a tenth of a micron of aluminum deposited on it, which gives a very high reflectivity. And these telescopes really work. This is, again, the large binocular telescope. This was the first light image taken in October of 2005. This is an incredible image here, taken from a knowing system. Looking at, there's a star that's blocked out using a special knowing technique. These are planets around that star. So this telescope is so powerful, it can see not just stars, it can actually see planets around other stars. We can watch these over time and we can see the orbit. Right? This is fantastic. People didn't imagine you could have done this 20 years ago. This is an image that I just love here. So the big circle that you see is one of the moons of Jupiter, the moon Io. And you see the large binocular telescope is looking at it, and see these bright things. This is taken in the infrared at 2 micron wavelengths. These bright things are volcanoes. These are volcanoes on the moon of Io. The really cool thing about this is the thing in front, that's a different Jupiter moon. That's the moon of Europa. It's coming between us and Io. And so it's occulting it. And so you can see some really interesting things. One is you see the diffraction point spread function. This is what you get when you have two telescopes that are separated by some distance, creating a phased image of something that's sharp. You see fringes. Okay? If you study diffraction, you can predict exactly what this would be. And you can see those are the point spread function. But as the occulting happens, you see the fringes distort, they shift. And this verifies that the whole system works exactly as we would have predicted. Okay, so back to optical testing. My expertise is not optical testing. I like the astronomy, and so does Gus Fund for me. But really, what I do is the testing. So the challenge in testing is to be able to measure these mirrors such that we can make them. And the mirrors have a complex shape. So this, again, shows the aspheric departure of one of the giant Magellan telescope mirror segments. And we think about, when we make things, we think about waves, right? The number of waves of departure from the Vesuvius sphere is 23,000. So typically, we would do something that's this big, it might have a few hundred waves of asymmetric departure. We'd work pretty hard. This has many thousands of waves. So it's a challenging thing to measure. We have to measure it to a precision, ultimately to an accuracy, of a hundredth of a wave. So that's the challenge. How do you do that? And it's harder than that, because if you come up with a way to do it, and we implement it, and some little thing went wrong and we didn't know it, if we didn't check it, we could make the wrong mirror. So we have to have an independent verification. So starting with things we know, things that are common, you can measure spherical shapes with an interferometer. That's easy. You buy the interferometer and you just use it. For modest aspherics, you can make a null corrector. This takes the wavefront from the interferometer and distorts it to create a wavefront that lets us measure an aspheric surface. And this is what we use for the 6.5 and the 8.4 meter mirrors, the on-axis mirrors. But the null corrector from the GMT requires some really special things. There are other techniques that are used for small optics that just aren't practical for large optics. You can do sub-aperture measurements of different types and then put them together. We use computer-generated holograms for a lot of our metrology. A computer-generated hologram is, fundamentally, it's a glass plate with a pattern written onto it that the diffraction from that pattern gives us a wavefront that we want, or it changes the wavefront by an amount that we want. And we feed that spherical wavefront from the interferometer, and the computer-generated hologram gives us the aspheric wavefront. It gives us a null measurement of a surface. Okay. This is a common way to measure aspheric surfaces. In fact, one of the two companies that I started, Arizona Optical Metrology, we sell computer-generated holograms. And we sell a lot of them to different people doing different types of metrology, of things sort of in this scale. A single computer-generated hologram can't be used for the GMT, but I'll show you how we use them. And so with the CGH, we can measure aspheric departures up to about 1,000 waves. And we can do it to an accuracy of about 1 nanometer. And these are some of the CGHs, what they look like. They just look like glass pattern, or like glass plates. And you see the diffraction from them. You can see the different colors that come off, kind of like a disc that you look at. But they're very specialized because the writing of these patterns, these line patterns on here, have very particular shapes that give us an accurate control of the wavefront. So the line pattern is kind of wiggly lines that look like this. The pitch between these may be 10 microns or so. Okay? And then that gives us a phase front that we want. And there are two classes of these. We can have a pattern that's written onto a substrate that blocks the light. We call that an amplitude hologram. Or we can etch it into the glass. And this gives us a phased pattern. And the way we create them is to use equipment that's built for making computer circuits. Computer circuits, if you ever look at one, it has a whole bunch of little funny-shaped lines. Okay. And they may have 12 or 15 different layers of different things, each one of which has different shaped lines. Each of those layers is manufactured by, there's a thing called a photomask first, that's written on a writing machine. That's imaged onto the silicon. Okay, and then there's chemistry and different things that happen to turn that image into maybe metal or ion implantation or some other thing that's put on there. But it's the writer that's the key thing. These writers already exist to be able to make integrated circuits that are fantastic. So if we can write a different pattern, then we can use it for a different application. So what we do is we create in a computer a pattern that looks like this, where these are all little segments. These are little rectangles. Okay? But you see the ensemble of them, all of them together, looks like a continuous fringe pattern. The writer knows how to make rectangles. It doesn't know how to make fringe patterns. But it doesn't know the difference. When we send our files to them, they think we're making integrated circuits. But they make these photomasks for us, and we use them for diffractive optics. And so the writing goes like this. We write the pattern onto photoresist. This is with an electron beam. This is developed, and then the resist covers a thin layer of metal that's on here. Use chemistry to etch away the metal. And so then we're left with the metal here. Remove the resist. This is then a glass plate with a metal pattern on it. That metal pattern is defined where the electron beam goes. Okay? And then we can go one step further and etch that into the glass. The key thing is that the electron beam here can write onto these substrates that are 150 millimeters square with an accuracy of about 10 nanometers. Okay? It can position its writing spot with incredible accuracy because that's what the computer industry already needs. So let me just use that to create our patterns. And the pattern distortion is what defines our performance. We actually have the ability to measure pattern distortion incredibly accurately because that's important for the computer industry. The distortion is absolutely critical to them, so they've built in the quality control checks to be able to quantify, to know how precise the writing is. And then that lets us know how precise our holograms are. So we write these little features on here, which are unresolved in our application, and then there's another instrument that goes and finds all those features. And it can measure the positions of those to an accuracy of a few nanometers. That combination gives us the ability to create wavefronts that are accurate to a thousandth of a wave. And then we can use that for metrology for all kinds of things. We can, with the holograms, we can do complex things. Any wavefront we want, if we can think of it clearly, then we can write a computer program that defines it. And then we can turn that into a set of lines that a writer can make. And then we can get a piece of glass that will have that. That whole process takes about a month. Okay, so we can do this pretty quickly. So this shows what a computer-generated hologram would look like. But each one of these lines represents 100 real lines. If I plot this for real, you can't see it. So there's the pattern in the center that's used for wavefront correction. There's a pattern on the outside that's used for alignment. And so this shows how that's used. Our interferometer has light that goes through the center pattern here that we'll end up using for our wavefront. This outside region, that light diffracts back into the interferometer, and we can use that to position and tilt the CGH with respect to the interferometer. It turns out we can do all kinds of things with that. So this is an image from an interferometer or a CGH, so there's these different patterns here. These different patterns are used for aligning different aspects of a complex system. And CGHs are incredibly powerful in this way. We can use them for different things. So one thing we can do is we can take our CGH and project patterns. Okay, if we take a CGH and we design it so it brings light to focus someplace, we can use that. And so this is for measuring an off-axis aspheric mirror where the position of the mirror is important. So what we do is we create these things we call optical fiducials. And then we can go find them. So this is an off-axis parabola. And there are four of these things. This is a spot created by the CGH. There are four of them. There's one here, one here, one here, one here. And we use that to position the target. Okay, so back to geometry. Optical testing for a large binocular telescope, the primary mirror has about 1.4 millimeters of aspheric departure, and it's axis symmetric, because the mirror's axis. Okay, it's an on-axis parabola. It's F1, so it's pretty steep. So that was measured using an interferometer with a null corrector, with a set of lenses that compensate the aspheric shift. And we have the assembly that we put at the center of curvature 20 meters away from the primary. And this enabled us to measure the large binocular telescope here and to make them. We used a CGH for this. Remember I told you one of the problems with metrology is that we have to know that it's right. So we didn't use a CGH to measure the mirror. In this case, we used a CGH to measure the test system. So normally, the test system would reflect light off of the mirror and measure what its shape is. We have this smaller CGH, 23 centimeters, that we put in front of the test system. The CGH is made to very high accuracy, and it's designed so that it looks to the test system exactly like a perfect primary mirror. And so if we have any error in our test optics in our measurement system, it would show up when we check it with this. And so this gives us a check. We know when we take this mirror to the telescope that we don't have a problem with our test optics because we measure them with a different system. So back to the Giant Magellan Telescope. So this has, again, 8.4 meter mirror segments, and these guys, again, they're off-axis. They're off-axis portions of a paraboloidal mirror. So when we make a comparison of LVT aspheric departure and the test optics that we know, we see two problems. We can't scale this up for GMT for two reasons. One is that the aspheric departure is wildly different. It's much, much larger and it's not symmetric. The other is if we just look at where the light needs to go, okay, this is a mirror segment, we need to go to center of curvature to be able to collect the light, that's 36 meters away. Okay, our facility is only 25 meters tall. And so we can't do the same thing at all. We can't just build a new facility. So what we did is we built what I call the mother of all null correctors. Okay, I told you what the null corrector is. This is fundamentally a null corrector, but it's incredibly complex. So the primary mirror segment's down here. Its axis is over here. Okay, the fact that it's part of an axis symmetric parent, we sort of lose. To be able to fit this test in our building, we have a mirror that we mount at the top of the tower that reflects light back down. And then we have a system of with a mirror and a computer-generated hologram that provides the rest of the correction. So we have an interferometer that sends light through CGH off of one powered mirror, off of another powered mirror. That whole assembly is our null corrector. That reflects light off the mirror as that light goes back on itself and everything's perfect and we have a null class. So this shows what it looks like in our tower. So the mirrors up here, we call this the fold sphere because it does two things. It folds the beam so we can fit it into our tower. It's also a spherical mirror. This mirror itself is 3.8 meters in diameter, which is bigger than most people's telescopes. And a mirror that's this big, it's difficult to control its shape. So to be able to build this test, we had to make that mirror, and we had to build a system that measures the shape of that mirror. The center of curvature of that mirror is down here on the floor. There's another interferometer that looks at this mirror to make sure the shape is right when we measure this mirror. This is the small optics assembly here that contain the mirror and the CGH. And so this is our facility. It's in the east wings of, on the east side of Arizona Stadium. Here's the tower that sticks up. This is 28 meters above the ground. It's the top of this cone. The tower's inside of here. This is what it looks like inside. This is the test tower. This is the test tower that we used for our previous mirrors, for the Martian Microwave Telescope mirrors. It wasn't strong enough to be able to work for GMT. Oops. So we replaced it. We tore that down and we made a bigger tower that can hold this whole sphere all the way to the top. And then we built the rest of the system. So computer-generated hologram is in here. We have some specialized metrology for aligning that. This is a picture of that CGH. It has other patterns that are used for aligning it. We insert a alignment CGH. This is another piece of glass. And look at all the different patterns on this. Okay, we can put this in here, and this does two things. It lets us check that this thing's right. Okay, and it also lets us check that we put this thing in the right place. We have references for that. To be able to get the whole system correct, we use this machine called a laser tracker. Laser tracker sends out a laser beam that hits a corner cube, and it measures the distance by time of flight, and it measures its two angles. Okay, with that information, it knows where that corner cube is, and if it's calibrated, it can do that to about 25 microns under these sorts of spaces. So we have a laser tracker here that's built into this test that looks at reference features on this assembly. It looks at features on our fold sphere, and it looks at the mirror. At the same time, we're measuring the shape of this thing. This is why I call this the mother of all null correctors. This is incredibly complex, but this is what it takes to be able to make a mirror this shape. So to make a test, this system is always shooting its laser beams around and measuring where these parts are. This is a picture of some of the hardware here. This is the small optics assembly here. This is my tool, who's a giant man. Makes everything else look small compared to this. This is looking up at the fold sphere, so this is the top of the tower. This is 3.8 meters. This is what an interferogram looks like looking in here. And we see a couple of things in this interferogram. This is the mirror's near finished. Okay, and you might say, well, that looks like a crappy interferogram. It has a lot of astigmatism. Okay, and there are all of these wiggles. Okay, the astigmatism is something we get from alignment. And if we measure what it is, we can subtract it in software. All of these wiggles are due to the air movement. Okay, air movement in the facility. It's pretty good, but it's not perfect. Anyone's snapshot will have air motion in it. And so what we do is we make measurements over a period of about 1 hour and average them, and then the air motion effects average out. And so that gives us data that lets us calculate this thing, which we call phase map. This is the surface irregularity of the mirror, where the different colors represent different heights. And so the finished mirror is about 20 nanometers RMS departure from perfect. But how do you know you get it right? You build this thing with all this complexity, okay, we can expect that something would go wrong. So we build a separate system that measures the mirror. And this is called a scanning pentaprism system. This uses a very old and elegant idea. We have a paraboloid mirror, and we send light rays in parallel to the parent, to the axis. Then those rays will be reflected, and they'll all come to focus at the focal point of the paraboloid. And so what we do is we have this system here that uses pentaprism that shoots two beams of light that are parallel to each other, shoots those into the mirror, and we find out where they intersect up here. We put a camera, and then if we move one of these by measuring spot motion, we can measure the departure of the shape from a paraboloid. And if we're really careful, we can do this to a small fraction of a microradian in terms of surface slope, which is good enough for us to verify the mirror shape. This is what it looks like in profile, but the whole thing is an off-axis part. We need to measure the full surface. So to do that, our rail here with the scanning pentaprism is tilted. It's tilted like this, but to measure the whole thing, it actually rotates. So this rail rotates to different positions. It shows a picture of it. So this whole thing rotates to enable us to scan the whole mirror. We have one other optical test that's interesting, we call SCOTS, the Software Configurable Optical Test System. And this uses a simple idea. Where if we have a scene here that we know what it is, and we look at that scene in reflection, we can use software to figure out what the shape was of that thing in reflection. Okay, and we don't just use any old scene here, we use a computer screen with fringes on it, and we modulate them so that we can get really high performance. And this seems very simple, but in fact it turns out to be incredibly good. So when we first have the mirror polished out, okay, we go from grinding to polished, we want to measure it. We build this mother of all null correctors, and we get a measurement that looks like this. And you see that there are these areas here where the data looks bad. The data is bad there because the interferometer doesn't work well when the slopes are large. It loses information. So we implemented this SCOTS test, and the SCOTS test shows beautifully what's going on. The SCOTS test uses a computer screen. Okay, and then we use that test to be able to work the surface to get it closer until this showed very good data every place and we had good agreement. And that enabled us to make the part very efficiently. So the status for GMT, the first of the segments was finished 2012, quite some time ago. We have since been working on other mirrors mostly. So we only have one of these segments that's finished, but we have a whole pipeline of the other ones coming along. The second one was cast in 2012. This is the back of it here. It's prepared for the telescope. These are the telescope attachments. The third segment was cast in 2013. Okay, and it's just a bare casting here. The fourth segment was cast in 2015. And the fifth of the segment is just now being cast, the fifth. 15 seconds. Remember, there are 7 that we need, a center and 6 outside ones. We'll make 1 spare outside. We purchased the glass for the 6th, so we're very far along. The 4th segment was a special one because it was the center segment. The 6 segments on the outside are all the same. This one is in the center here. This is a giant center hole, and this required us to develop some mechanics that enable us to cast something with a giant center hole, which was a new challenge for us. But anyway, that's done. Okay, so that's the GMT. I want to talk about one other telescope here briefly that we've done. It's really cool. This is the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope. This is a very different type of telescope. So the GMT has this giant aperture so that it can see deep things and uses adaptive optics so that it can see sharp things. The LSST has a very different mission. The LSST has a wide field of view so that it can see a big area all at once. It's a big aperture, but it's not a giant aperture. It's 8.4 meters in diameter. And so what the LSST, the science mission, is it'll look at the whole sky, make short exposures, and look for changes in things. Okay? It has a wide field of view, a 3.5 degree of field of view, and it gets that with this 3-meter design, where light comes in from the star, hits the outer region, which is the primary, goes up and hits the secondary mirror, then comes back down, and it doesn't go through the center hole like the Cassegrain. It hits what we call the third mirror. Then that light comes up through some lenses to a focal plane up here. And this gives us a 3.5 degree field of view. What the University of Arizona made is the primary mirror, tertiary mirror combination. One piece of glass with both of these surfaces. And my company, Arizona Optical Systems, is actually making lenses that are up here. So this is the casting of this mirror. And you see, unlike the LBT, we can rotate at a particular rate that gives us the radius of curvature of the mirror. This has 2 different curvatures. So to be able to do this, we have to spin the inside at a different rate as you spin the outside. But that's not possible. So what we did is we cast it with a bunch of extra glass. We rotated it, so we spin it so that the curved glass follows this shape. And then inside of here, we have 5 tons of extra glass that we had to go remove with diamond tools. This shows us polishing it. Here we have a stress lap polisher on the primary mirror and our small tool polisher on the tertiary mirror on the inside. And here they're switched. Okay, we polish both of these, surfaces. The measurements for these had some special requirements. So we used computer-generated holograms as for this. The primary mirror measurement used lenses, and we qualified the lenses with a computer-generated hologram, exactly like what we did for LBT. The tertiary mirror was less aspheric, and so we used a computer-generated hologram as the null corrector for that. And then we used a second computer-generated hologram as the verification of the computer-generated hologram that was used to measure the mirror. So there's some interesting things here. There's a real advantage to putting both of these mirrors on the same substrate. The advantage is that both mirrors are on the same piece of glass, so they cannot get misaligned in the telescope. Okay? That's a real advantage for a telescope that's this steep and the sensitivities are tight. The disadvantage is they have to be manufactured correctly in the shop. You cannot accommodate them. And the way we did that is our computer-generated holograms, and remember, you can do anything with these, well, they created references. And so each of the computer-generated holograms creates a reference that we can use for alignment, and we can make sure that we have the same reference for this tertiary mirror as what we have as the primary mirror. There's another issue, which is the active optics, that these mirrors are fairly stiff, but we can still bend them in low order shapes. And so we have actuators that hold the mirrors with. And so in the telescope, we can bend the substrate, this piece of glass. The complexity is that it changes the shape of both of the mirrors at the same time, both the primary and the tertiary. What that means is if we made the primary and tested it, and then made a tertiary and tested it, and they had different shapes bent into them we could not correct by bending the substrate. So what we had to do was to measure both mirrors at the same time. That way we know that the state of the bending is exactly the same. Okay, so the final mirror, after much difficulty with technical things, we polished the outside L1 and the inside to something better than 20 nanometers. Okay, so in conclusion, boy, we live in exciting times for television. To be able to work on such fantastic things is, I'm just one of the luckiest people we've had. A technical thing, by combining stiff, lightweight mirrors, we can create giant telescopes that can do science that you couldn't do otherwise. And the advances in optical testing, especially the applications of computer-generated holograms, enables us to do things now that 10 years ago, or certainly 15 years ago, we wouldn't have known how to do it. So with that, I want to thank you for your attention and open up for questions.
Do you think this is the best way for creating with optical, with mirrors, solid?
Which is the best way?
It's the one, because we can find a very interesting report of what a telescope is and other kinds of approximation.
So, yeah, there are several ways to do different. Solve different problems. So the GMT design builds on technologies and things that we mostly already have. And so that enabled us to move ahead and make the primary mirror segments. We needed a new tower, but we were able to do that relatively quickly. For the other telescope concepts, to be able to make the number of primary mirror segments, to be able to make hundreds of segments is a different challenge. Okay, and so they haven't started making their segments yet. They started getting the glass for them. It's a different problem. Which one's harder? Which technology is better? It's impossible to say.
The question is about two, because $1 billion. Maybe Mexico is an amount that be able to put an entire institution.
Yeah, well, these telescopes, so the European Southern Observatory is a consortium of countries, including Brazil. And so that's money that's pulled together from multiple nationalities. The other telescopes, the TMT and the GMT, they're led by a consortium of different institutes. So GMT has 10 different partners. No one partner, actually. Now, we have some partners with a lot of money. Harvard is one, University of Chicago, Smithsonian, MIT. So they have partners that do have a lot of money. But $1 billion, I don't think anybody's going to come up with. And so it's the kind of thing that potentially a group of interested people could join together to do something that they couldn't do otherwise. But to be able to get to the next level of science, to be able to see the things that are too dim to see right now, requires a larger telescope. So there's tremendous motivation to be able to do this. You're right, it's very expensive.
What about the software used to design the telescopes?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
What about the software used? To design the telescopes.
The software?
Software, yeah.
Which
software do you use to do the design? The design?
No, well, there's so many different aspects. So, as you know, everything that's done now is really optimized with a computer. So, we start with optical design, with ZMAX or Code 5. We do straight light analysis, we do finite element modeling. Our Our data collection is usually taken with our custom software, and our data processing is done with custom software.
Well, I'm particularly concerned with the twin telescope, because it needs diffraction studies. What is the best software to design that kind of telescopes?
I'm sorry, I don't understand your question. Maybe we can talk afterwards. I'm sorry, I don't understand.
So what is the telescope going to be ready?
So
what's the
GMT is, it'll have initial first light with four segments, which will be three off-axis segments and a center segment. And construction is underway on the site now. And I think it's 2020 that they expect to have the initial hardware there. These dates keep slipping, and I'm not closely connected to the project, so I don't know exactly when that will be.
What are the spectral bands that you're expecting to see initially on that one?
The what?
The spectral bands.
Well, so our instruments cover the range of wavelengths that we can do good science from the ground. So all through the visible. Obviously UV, we don't see anything.
Right.
Once you get into the infrared, there are absorption bands.
Yeah, there's some areas.
But there are windows.
Yeah.
Okay, and so in the windows between 1 and 5, there that's where most of the science for these telescopes would be. That's where the adaptive optics works really well. And it turns out that most of the interesting things that we're looking at emit their light in visible sorts of wavelengths, but they're running away from us. And so it's redshifted out into the infrared. And so much of the science, much of the real science drivers for these is in the 1 to 5 sort of range. But there's also a lot in the thermal infrared going out to 30 microns. And certainly in visible, that's where we can make the best pictures. And things that are near the spectra in the visible have this fantastic information there. This doesn't go out into radio or terahertz, and we can't go into the UV.
Eric?
Well, that's very nice stuff. And many of the problems we could see, I can see behind what you didn't mention because it would be the complex. For instance, turbulence, temperature changes. So it's a headache, all the things that we must take into account for testing.
Oh yeah, so testing's hard because the tolerances required are tight. Everything is expensive and there's a lot of motivation to really get it right.
As the tower is
we have in our facility the tower is a steel tower, okay, and we have a double insulation. So we have insulated walls, and then there's an air like a room around it, and then insulated walls outside of that. And then we have air handlers that blow an enormous amount of air. There. So when the air handlers are on, you feel the wind. Okay? And so what that does is it equalizes the temperature of everything that's in there. Then to make our measurements, we turn those off. And everything is pretty much the same temperature. And then for about 1 hour, we'll have really nice measurements. After an hour, we'll start to see some things that make it more efficient for us to go stir the air back up and to try to average it out. There's some real art that comes from experience in being able to make good measurements in the presence of air, so I'm sure you know. And so all of our heat sources, we draw away anything that creates heat, it's ducted so that it doesn't go into the room, it's ducted out of the room.
When you talk about the GMT telescope, my question is, you talk about 14 seconds for supertwilight, deeper, right? So my question is, how do you control the deeper, the deep pocket plate?
For the LSST has 15 second exposures, and there's actually a shutter there's a rolling shutter in there. Okay? So the way LSST works is it moves to the right place, it makes a 15 second exposure with this rolling shutter. Then it moves, it takes 5 seconds to move and settle, and then does that again. Okay, and it does that all night long. So that over 3 nights, it can measure the full portion of the sky that it can see on that day. And then, of course, the Earth is rotating, and so it gets the full sky over a year. That instrument is so complex. It's a 65 centimeter focal plane. Okay, with 4 billion pixels in it. Okay, and so they're made in these rafts so that you can collect the light from each of these and read it out every 15 seconds. The electronics for that assembles in this dense packed thing behind it, and then there's a giant water cooling system. It's, you talk about money, it's, I don't know, tens of millions of dollars just in the hardware for the for that system.
One question,
Bob? We talked, we were talking to the laboratories about the difference between the world of science and the world of industry. How do you handle your planning, your scheduling, according with the contract that you receive? Because normally you have a lot of surprises during the process.
Yes.
And those surprises change your scheduling for developing the final product.
Yeah.
How do you handle it?
Well, that's the real challenge for something like this, because it's a one-of-a-kind telescope or a research project. People understand that if you're doing research, you don't know the answer, so it's going to take longer and money to solve problems you have. This project, at this point, can't afford that. So our primary thing was we got initial funding, not for the whole telescope, not at all. It was our initial funding, all of it went into making the first mirror so that we could find all those problems long before we actually needed to create all the mirrors. And so now that we're making multiple problems, multiple mirrors, now it's closer to an industry type of problem where it's replicating something that's already been done. And it's not that we don't have problems. We always have problems. Technical things always come up. As you know, you do technical things. That's the fun part, the challenge, but it's frustrating that it's very difficult to keep a schedule and budget in the presence of the real world. That's where we live, it's the real world. So for GMT, that was the primary risk reduction, was to make the small steps, I think the first one, before there was money or willingness to make the whole telescope. It means, though, that people like me always have a lot of pressure. Right, you probably feel the same. Because we have to have confidence to get the project started. Right? When I proposed the mother of all null correctors, I can't say, I think this might work. Because nobody would let me do it. The truth is, I thought it might work, but I couldn't say for sure. I could say, yes, this will work. We have these risks. And I have to be very, very careful about it. Right? I have to say, these are the risks, and I have to know what they are, and if somebody else goes along with that, they did, I said, all right, we'll fund you to do that. As long as they understand the risks, if I say, we don't know how well this will work, if they can fund something else to solve that risk, then we're okay. Or they can understand that we might have a problem later. And so, all of these things ended up very different than what our initial planning looked like because of complications with the real, making the real things work, making them practical.
Thank you.